everyone, I'm Rebecca and I am the district rep for District 6 and I am a member of St Paul's GB Company 160th in Lisburn. I work mainly with the baby section, but I also teach Bible class to the seniors, so hopefully I will know what I'm talking about.
And I'm Lauren and I'm the youth rep for GBNI and youth form, and I am in Trinity Presbyterian in Hockle, and I also do the seniors, so can't promise I know what I'm talking about, but enjoy the seniors.
So that's the whole reason we're doing this, it's a learning curve, isn't it? Because, well, we're going to be talking about Rahab, and Rahab's one of those characters. She seems like a minor character, but then when you really get into it, she actually realizes how influential she was. Like, Rahab's one of the few women who's mentioned in the lineage of Jesus, so clearly she was quite important, like important enough to be mentioned in the Gospels.
Yeah, because that's one of the things that whenever I was reading the book, the Faithful book, they talked about how she was one of the only two women who were mentioned in Hebrews 11 when they have like the Hall of Fame, almost, as some people call it, about people who had faith throughout the Bible, and she's one of two women in it, which is crazy because like it's one of those stories you could just so easily read and kind of skip on past and not really think much of her, but actually whenever you delve into it you can learn so much more, and I know I have just from looking at this.
Oh, absolutely. Like, I didn't realize she was actually the mother of Boaz. Like, it seems like such a simple thing that you'd realize, but like Rahab, Boaz, Ruth, and then influential women in the life of Jesus, and very clearly a significant character to be talking about.
Yeah. So that sort of takes us on to then our first question about what challenged you. And definitely, like, as you said, it's something that, like, she was in directly in the lineage of Jesus, and like she's, you kind of think like, oh, Jesus was the Son of God, he's going to have this amazing, like all these really like rich and royal people in his lineage, but this was a prostitute. It's somebody you wouldn't expect to be connected with Jesus, although we know Jesus dealt with people like this all the time, but it's crazy that she actually was part of the lineage of Jesus.
Yeah, because she was a woman who lived on the fringes of society, like both metaphorically because of her job and what she did for a living, but also quite literally she lived on the city walls. Like, she was literally ostracized directly to the outside of the city. But it was those people who were on the fringe and on the outskirts who were so significant to the Hebrews, because without Rahab living where she lived in a very strategic place, they would not have been able to infiltrate the city. They would not have been able to go in and spy and scope out the land. And because she was in this position, she was able to help them.
Yeah.
One thing I'm saying was she took a real risk in like helping these people, people who she had no reason to trust, because she knew what they were there to do. But she'd heard the stories of them. She knew what they were going to do and what they were meant to do. And she realized that these people are doing this for a God who is all powerful. And who am I to doubt that? Who am I not to trust that? And because of that one little act, she was able to change her entire belief system, which is quite amazing.
I know, it's just, it was so crazy to read the story and realize how much faith she had, that like God made her such a huge part of his plan. And she was just this woman who, as you say, she was completely on the outskirts of society. And she, like, the part in the book that really stood out to me and challenged me was the writer said Rahab wasn't trying to be a hero, she was just trying to be obedient. And that really challenged me, because like, you kind of read all these stories about these amazing things people are doing in the Bible and you think, wow, like they're amazing and people call them heroes, but that wasn't her goal. She wasn't setting out to be in the lineage of Jesus. She was just being obedient to what God was calling her to do. And as you say, like, she was so brave, she could have been killed for doing what she did, but she stood out and because she thought it was the right thing to do. And that really, really challenged me.
Yeah, it's quite a challenging thing to think of, because if Rahab didn't do what she did, we would not have the lineage of Jesus as we know it. Yeah. And through one little act of choosing to hide these men who were being pursued persistently by guards, she was able to do something radical and basically bring the walls of the strongest city at that time down around her, and only her house stood standing. Like, that to me is just amazing. Like, when I was a kid, I always visualized it very literally, like a big circle and then one house in the middle just standing with the red cord hanging down.
I know, it's as you say, trying to actually imagine that is crazy. And I suppose that sort of takes us on to what we learned about Rahab. And as you already mentioned, like both of us, I never realized that she actually was Boaz's mother. And everyone knows the story about Boaz and Ruth. But that's something I really learned about her, was like she was such a huge part. And like her faith really just made such an impact on the rest of history as we know it. And as we mentioned already, she's mentioned in the Gospels, she's mentioned in other places in the New Testament. And what her small role, which she probably thought was something so small, was taking in these men, actually changed history.
Oh, totally. And I mean, the thing is that I find really strange is it wasn't like a small act, yes, but it was also she, from that moment of choosing to save these men, she converted and put her faith totally and wholly in God. Like, no questions asked. Because she'd heard the story, she'd heard about them coming down from Egypt, she had heard about the manna and the quail. She'd heard all these stories and how they were going from city to city to city and not being challenged because they had a God on their side who was all powerful. And she chose to put not only her life in his hands, but the life of her entire family and everyone who lived in her house, which I did a bit of extra reading on it because, you know, I had to. The people who lived in her house weren't just her family, but her house was actually the brothel, so it would have been other women of like ill repute. And God chose this woman who was so ostracized from society, who was so put down and beaten. And God chooses all the broken people in order to pass on as much important messages. Like Mary Magdalene is a good example in the New Testament because she obviously was in the same line of work as Rahab. But God chose her to have an influential and significant role. God chooses the people who aren't perfect, which, I mean, gives us all a bit of hope because we don't have to be perfect all the time because we have God who loves us and who will support us.
Yeah, definitely. Like, as you say, whenever you're reading the story and you read that she's a prostitute, you think there must have been someone, there must have been people who were in a better place to help those men. But God didn't need someone with a good job. He didn't need somebody with a good reputation. He just needed somebody with faith, and that's exactly who she was. And that's something that also was written in the book. I think it was actually in one of the very first paragraphs. It said a person's work isn't their identity. And I think that's another challenge to us today, because there's so much pressure on what you do in your career and your ambitions and all that. But that's not who we are, especially as Christians. Like, we're not called to be of course, like, God will use us through our jobs, but that's not meant to be our sole identity. Our sole identity is meant to be in God and in Christ. And that really challenged me as well, was just that your work isn't your identity. In the same way, Rahab, although her job was obviously not a desirable job, but that wasn't her entire identity, because God is able to see past that and actually use her for such a big work as she did. And it's just crazy to see that God looked past all that, and he was able to use her in such an amazing way, and in her obedience and her faith, really. That was really what made her known, not her job.
Yeah, something that was also interesting in the book, like the beautiful book, was the author talked about like how much stock we put in like the titles we give ourselves, like mother, daughter, doctor, teacher, friend. But we put all this value in the titles that we give ourselves, but we don't look at the titles that God gives us, like as his child or his servant. These are the titles which are more important. These are the things that we should value, not the ones that we want to give ourselves or what society expects us to be. Because as Christians, we know that we have been labeled as Christians. We automatically are seen as other, but we're not other. We are the generation. We are God's people who he has chosen to pass on his message and his good news, and that's just an amazing privilege to be able to do. And that's what he did for Rahab. He gave her that privilege to serve him in a very major way. I'm going to just say it's a major way, because without her they wouldn't have been able to get into Jericho. They wouldn't have been able to break down that wall literally and break through into the city.
Yeah. I know, because that's exactly something I noticed as well as in the book, is she described them as that as a million little moments to make ourselves faithful. So as you said, it was such a small little thing, but it like made them be able to enter the whole city and move their plans forward. And I suppose we sometimes feel the pressure to really do big things for God, and we have to be doing really really important things, but it can be a million little things that we all do in our everyday lives and that can contribute to something really massive happening for God. And I suppose then that brings us onto our next question about what did you learn about God? Was there anything that stood out to you really about anything that you learned about God through Rahab?
I'm just going to pick up on what you said about the million little things, because that is something I've been thinking about it for a while in like my quiet time and my reflection, but reading this really brought it into perspective in a way I'd never really thought about before. God is so present in every single tiny moment in our lives. And it hit me one morning when I woke up and like at stupid o'clock in the morning to go to school and teach. I woke up at 6 and I was like, the fact that I'm able to wake up now in a place where I'm safe and breathe in fresh air and look at the world around me and hear the sound of nature around me, that is a miracle. And that God is still present in that. The fact that I'm able to go to school and see like 31 insane little children running around and just living life to the fullest, that is a miracle. The fact that I'm able to go and have conversations with friends and family and see all these amazing things, it's just amazing. And God has given us that incredible privilege. And we sometimes forget about that, because we get so bogged down with the stresses of life and all the negative thoughts and all the pressure we put on ourselves. But it's so nice just to think of like the fact that you're able to get up in the morning and each day is a new one. Why would we not value that? It's just an incredible, incredible privilege and a gift that we've been given. And sometimes we lose sight of that, I think.
Yeah, as you say, we just take it for granted that when we go to bed, we're going to wake up the next morning and live our lives as normal. And obviously we've known a wee bit of disruption in the last year or so with COVID, things have changed, but God is still there, and God is still giving us, it, as you say, air to breathe and food to eat and family and friends to talk to. And as you say, it's something that we take for granted so often, and it's really, really important, I think, to take a step back sometimes and kind of reassess what all God's given us. Go ahead.
I know we have all the challenges of COVID and things like that, but God's also given us a way to overcome those things. Like the fact that we're able to talk on Zoom, like we've never met in person, but the fact that we're able to see each other on Zoom and like have these really quite deep conversations is a gift that we've been given, and we wouldn't have that without God putting that into someone's mind to do.
Yeah.
And yes, like there's going to be challenges that are different in the future, but we know that if we put our trust in Him and obey Him, we can get through any sort of challenge.
Yeah, it's such a challenge to us all just to as you say, obey God and put our trust in Him, and he'll make a way for us, because that's what He does. He's done this through Rahab, He's done it through so many other stories in the Bible and through people around us. Something as well I really picked up and what I learned about God through the book was the picture of the scarlet cord, as we've already mentioned, about her holding the scarlet cord out of the window. The writer of in this book, she compared it to the bloodstained doorposts during the did you notice this bit?
Yeah,
she kind of did a parallel between them, and it's something I never, again, it shows the benefits of reading these books. It's something I never would have even thought of. But it shone a picture of God's salvation and God's mercy, and that in the same way that whenever all the people were painting their doorposts red so that the angel of death would pass over their house, God gave them a way out of the awful situation they were in the same way as God gave Rahab a way out of her city's destruction and these men. God did that for us as well. He sent His Son for our salvation, and just that parallel, it really struck a chord with me, a scarlet chord. I just thought that was an amazing picture of Jesus and God sending His Son right through a story from the Old Testament where Jesus hadn't even came yet, but it was such a picture of God's provision and God's mercy.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah,
I know. The scarlet cord is actually where we get the term scarlet woman from.
Oh really?
It's when I read a book, because I again had to do extra reading. It's called Wicked Women of the Bible, and it looks at all these like controversial women of the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a whole chapter on Rahab, and it was about how the scarlet cord is where we get the term scarlet woman from. And then in that book, it sort of takes how we should reclaim the title of scarlet woman as not being controversial, but being controversial because of God, not in spite of God.
Yeah,
which I just think is a really nice image. And again, it's just amazing how many, it's just a very visual image, like the blood on the doorpost and the scarlet cord hanging down, like the red robes of Mary Magdalene. It's all very, very visual, and it just shows how deeply entrenched and entwined those images are in the Bible and how much it carries through.
Yeah, amazing. It's just, as you say, or as you said earlier about visualizing that one house in the city, as you say, it's just the imagery and the story is amazing, and it all has meaning because God planned it to have meaning. So yeah, like that's something that really stood out to me and I thought was amazing. Is there anything else that you kind of learned from the book?
Just sort of, again, we take so many titles off of ourselves, like, and we feel the need to fulfill them all, and eventually we will burn ourselves out trying to fulfill all these things that people expect of us. But it's learning to prioritize what is important, not only to you, but what's important in your life journey. Like, because God has a path for you that he wants you to follow, and sometimes we might fall away from it or stray from it, but he will guide us back onto it. And if we do fall away from the path, I personally believe that we fall for a reason, to show us what is possible without God, and with him what is possible. So that's what the book sort of challenged me to think, because the author talks a lot about how she sort of not fell from the path, but sort of the path didn't go the way she anticipated, and what she learned from that. And just a very nice image of, like, yes, our path may have lots of twists and turns and we may trip and stumble along the way, but we have a Father God who is standing right beside us and is ready to catch us when we fall and ready to help us back onto that path, which is just, again, very comforting image just to think of, especially in uncertain times.
Definitely. I think that's a really nice note to leave on. So yeah, as me and Rebecca have chatted about so many things to learn through the story of Rahab, about Rahab herself, about God, about ourselves, but yeah, it's been really, really interesting. I've loved reading it, and again, as we both said, we've learned a lot through it that we didn't even know before, and it's a story we both have known before this. So yeah.
And if you haven't read it, go and read it. Like, it's a great read. And there's so many things online that you can read that will support you. Like Bible Gateway's got lots of resources that you can use, and it will help you do a deep dive if that's what you're interested in. And there's some great YouTube videos as well if you want to read some more about Rahab and learn a bit more about her journey.
Yeah, it's definitely worth doing the next reading, because as we both said as well, there's so many things we didn't pick up just from reading the passage that from extra reading, and you told me things there tonight I didn't know either. It's amazing to actually be able to read all these extra things. So thanks for watching, and be sure to watch out the other Faithful vlogs, and keep an eye on the GBNI Youth Forum Instagram and Facebook for our next series and what's coming up. Bye.
Bye.